Good morning.
Good morning.
I want to worship today at Abiding Word. Special welcome to guests and visitors who are with us this Sunday. This Sunday is the first in the season of Lent. And on this Sunday in the church year, our focus is on our Savior Jesus as he begins his work of delivering us from sin and death and hell. And this morning, the focus is on Jesus facing the devil in the wilderness, overcoming that temptation. And today, through the gospel, Jesus gives us the victory. That he won for us with his death and resurrection. We get to live in that victory this morning. A couple notes about our service. Be printed on the service folder and the screen in front of you. Also be using the red pew hymnals for our different hymns. We then begin this morning with our opening hymn, number 106, Come to Calvary's Holy Mount. Please stand. We worship in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near the true heart and confess our sins to God our Father, asking him, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, to grant us forgiveness. Holy and merciful Father, I confess that I am by nature sinful, and that I have disobeyed you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have done what is evil and failed to do what is good. For this, I deserve your punishment, both now and in eternity. But I am truly sorry for my sins, and trusting in my Savior, Jesus Christ, I pray, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. God, our Heavenly Father, has been merciful to us and has given his only Son to be the atoning sacrifice for all of our sins. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. In the peace of our forgiveness, we join in singing hymn 275, Blessed Be the God of Israel. Lord, our strength, the battle of good and evil rages within and around us, and our ancient foe tempts us with his deceits and empty promises. Keep us steadfast in your word, and when we fall, raise us up again and restore us through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. Two scripture lessons for this morning show a connection. The Old Testament lesson from Genesis chapter 3 is the fall into sin as Adam and Eve are tempted and give into those temptations, and through their sin bring death into this world. Second lesson from the book of Romans, the Apostle Paul tells us how our Lord Jesus came to live and die and rise again and to change what Adam and Eve had done. We see the impact of sin over all people, and we see the impact of our Savior and his righteousness to all people. First lesson from Genesis chapter 3. Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden?" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say, you must not eat from the tree that's in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die." "You will not surely die," the serpent said to the woman, "for God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be open, and you'll be like God, knowing good and evil." When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye, and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it. Then the eyes of both of them were open, and they realized they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. Then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and they hid from the Lord God among the trees in the garden. But the Lord God called to the man, "Where are you?" He answered, "I heard you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid." He said, "Who told you you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree that I commanded you not to eat from?" The man said, "The woman you put here with me, she gave me some fruit from the tree, and I ate it." And the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this you have done?" The woman said, "The serpent deceived me, and I ate." So the Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, cursed are you above all livestock and all wild animals. You will crawl on your belly, and you will eat dust all the days of your life. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head, and you will strike his heel." Then St. Paul in Romans chapter 5. "Therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man, and death through sin, and in this way death came to all people because all sinned. To be sure, sin was in the world before the law was given, but sin is not charged against anyone's account where there's no law. Nevertheless, death reigned from the time of Adam to the time of Moses, even over those who did not sin by breaking a command, as did Adam, who was a pattern of the one to come. But the gift is not like the trespass. For if the many died by the trespass of the one man, how much more did God's grace and the gift that came by the grace of the one man, Jesus Christ, overflow to the many? Nor can the gift of God be compared with the result of one man's sin. The judgment followed one sin and brought condemnation, but the gift followed many trespasses and brought justification. For if by the trespass of the one man death reigned through that one man, how much more will those who receive God's abundant provision of grace and of the gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ? Consequently, just as one trespass resulted in condemnation for all people, so also one righteous act resulted in justification and life for all people. For just as through the disobedience of the one man the many were made sinners, so also through the obedience of the one man the many will be made righteous." This is the word of the Lord. This time I have our children's message. I invite our children to come forward for a short lesson. Jacob, good morning. It's great to see everybody today. Today, you remember what I said beginning? It's the first Sunday in what season of the church year? Remember what I said, Haley? Lent, yes, the first season in Lent. There's a tradition that some people have during Lent, and they like to give things up Lent. Have you ever heard of that, somebody giving something up for Lent? Ask your parents about it. They can tell you about it. They probably maybe give something up for Lent. Usually it's something you kind of like to do. So this morning I brought you an example. You have one in your pocket, don't eat it. But these are what is this, Blake, you know? It's a Hershey Kiss. Luke, you are eyeing that up. Just leave them right there. So if I asked you, you had two Hershey Kisses. Luke, could you give these up for Lent? Yeah, you probably would, right? If you had just two. But now in this sack over here that John was looking into, there's a whole bunch of Hershey Kisses in there. Could you get, don't get too excited, but could you give all those up for Lent? And not just those, but we got some of these. I don't know how this candy is in my house and nobody knew about it, but there's some of those too. Give all this, there's a whole, bags and bags. Can you give it all up? Yeah, maybe, right? That's hard. You got a lot of it. Today, I want to talk to you about something God did for us. What did God give us? Annabelle? So he gave up everything for us, didn't he, right? Think about that a lot during the season of Lent, of all that God gave up for us. He gave his one and only Son. God so loved the world that he gave, right? Jesus came into this world, he gave up his life, he shed his blood so that we can get everything. We get the forgiveness of sins. We get eternal life with Jesus in heaven. It doesn't cost us anything. It's God's gift to us. That's an amazing gift that God gives. During Lent, I'm not going to ask you to give up candy. I won't ask you to give up anything for Lent. You can if you want to. Parents can do that if you want to. That's okay. It can be a good custom. It helps us focus on God. But this Lent, and not just this Lent, but every day, I am going to ask you to remember what God gave up for you and to thank him for that. To thank him that he gave you his only son, that he gave up his life so that you can have absolutely everything now and eternal life with him in heaven. So on this first Sunday of Lent, we're going to close with a prayer. I'm going to thank him for giving us everything so that we can have everything. Let's pray about that, okay? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for giving us your Son to be our Savior. We thank you, Jesus, for giving up your life so that we can have forgiveness and eternal life with you. Help us to live in that forgiveness every day and to live as your people who have everything now because we have everything with you in heaven. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. You can return to your parents. Our service continues with our hymn of the day. And that hymn of the day is 726. It's printed on an insert in your worship folder, also on the screen in front of you. This is one of those hymns that beautifully tells the story of what this Sunday is really all about. God fighting our enemies, God defeating our enemies. And as you go through these verses, you'll see that theme. Jesus fought and Jesus won, and we have the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. We join in Christ, the Lord of hosts, unshaken. Grace and peace are yours from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. The text for our sermon this morning is taken from the Gospel of Matthew chapter 4. And Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. After fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. The tempter came to him and said, "If you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread." Jesus answered, "It is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. "If you're the Son of God," he said, "throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and they will lift you up in their hands, so that you will not strike your foot against a stone." Jesus answered him, "It is also written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. "All this I will give you," he said, "if you will bow down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away from me, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." And the devil left him, and the angels came and attended him. This is the gospel of our Lord. If you've heard the phrase, if you fail to plan, you plan to fail. Or, if you aim at nothing, that's what you're going to get. You probably understand the idea and the importance of making a plan and following through on that. I had a great illustration in the early service this morning. Every Sunday, I plan to have everything go right with the technology. And when I looked down to turn my mic on, it was red, which means I had failed to plan to check my batteries. But that's another story. It does not really matter that much in some situations if you fail to plan. Maybe it's a loved one's birthday or there's an anniversary. Now, that can be a very big deal, but if you fail to plan for such an occasion, the good news is there's always next year. Some situations are a bit more important, planning for a major purchase or something, or planning for retirement. If you fail to do those things, you can possibly still overcome. Right? Enough time, you can work your way out of a hole. And so in earthly situations, planning doesn't always have to be there. You can still get by. It's much more serious when we consider spiritual situations. It's more difficult to overcome a spiritual failure to plan. And quite frankly, it has eternal consequences. If you fail to plan spiritually, you fail to address those issues, whoever believes and is baptized will be saved. Whoever does not believe will be condemned. Those are serious issues. I think most Christians have an idea about spiritual planning, at least on their radar. We think about church, think about making that a part of our weekly schedule. We think about devotional time, you know, spending time in God's Word personally or as a family with other believers. People plan about babies and baptizing them and bringing them up in the Lord. They make plans when people are thinking about getting married. They plan around God's Word when there's a death, right? We're always planning spiritually. But I also think it's an area we recognize we could use some help. We can use some help because the Bible makes it clear that there's a real battle going on. And it's a battle we're not always aware of, we're not always engaged in. In his letter to the Ephesians, the Apostle Paul wrote some really familiar words about putting on the full armor of God. He's talking about using the word of God. And there's a verse in there, Paul says, so that when the day of evil comes, you can stand your ground. And the point Paul is making is the believer has to be equipped with the word of God because the day of evil is coming. And that's not just something off in the distance. It's every day. It's today. It's right now. He's talking about the temptations that we face constantly. The devil doesn't give up at certain times in our life. He's not going to let his foot off the gas. He's always after us. He's always out to get us, so much so that we don't even realize all that he's doing to pull us away from the Lord. When we remember that, and the Bible clearly teaches that that's the fight we're in, we might be looking for a little bit of help. How can I plan to face this enemy that I don't even see? How can I plan to conquer these situations that I'm not even aware of? There's good news for us this morning as we find Jesus. As we find Jesus facing the devil's temptation, as we see Jesus in action for us, he gives us a proven strategy for overcoming temptation. To recognize it and to resist it. And then when we see our failure, we repent and we repeat that cycle. Jesus has been in the wilderness for 40 days, and the devil comes after him. He's been fasting for 40 days. And at the end of those 40 days, the devil shows up and begins to bring these temptations to Jesus. Why don't you turn these stones into bread? You must be hungry. 40 days is a long time to go without food. That's a pretty good mark, Jesus. Why don't you get yourself something to eat? Man does not live on bread alone. The devil then uses the scriptures to tempt Jesus. Why don't you prove that God will do what he says he will do and send his angels to lift you up? And Jesus recognizes and resists with the word of God. Don't put him to the test. And then the temptation comes that Jesus could have it all and avoid suffering. Worship the Lord your God and serve him only. Jesus recognized those temptations and he resisted them with the powerful word of God. And something always strikes me when I read this section of scripture. It seems like it would have been easy. These seem like no-brainer temptations. Jesus is the Almighty Son of God. He's got nothing to prove. Right? Jesus knows the word perfectly, so of course he can resist. These seem like easy temptations for him to overcome. But understand that temptation is not just to do something sinful. The temptation goes on in the mind. The Bible says that thinking sinfully is just as bad as acting sinfully. So Jesus, facing these temptations, recognizing them, is recognizing all the different ways that the devil is trying to get him off track spiritually. Even if he doesn't act on them, he's still got to think through that temptation and resist it. That's hard for us. Because we can focus on the outward action and we say, I am not doing that sin. But then we recall what the scriptures say. Anyone who hates his brother is a murderer. One who looks lustfully has already committed adultery in the heart. Those who know the good things they ought to do and don't do them, they sin. And when God says that his people worship him in vain because their hearts are far from him, even when they're going through the motions, that's a strong condemnation for people who just go through the motions. Temptation comes in so many different ways. King David says, Lord, forgive my hidden faults. We have so many sins that we're so unaware of, we don't even remember them. There's so many temptations that come flying at us and we don't know where to turn. We see Jesus recognize, we see Jesus resist, and then we think about our own life. We're not seeing it. And we're often given into it. So what do you do? Look back at Jesus, Redouble your efforts. Try to follow his plan more faithfully. Try to be more aware. Try to get a better knowledge of the Word of God. Sure, those things are good. But we repent first. We repent by confessing before God that we have sinned over and over again. We repent by looking then in faith to our Lord Jesus, who successfully conquered temptation. See, Jesus didn't give in to the devil while he was out in the wilderness. And for the next 3 years of his life, he didn't give in to the devil. Jesus continued to recognize those temptations, even when they came from very close to home, his own disciples, his own people. And he resisted them all the way to the cross. And when he was hanging on the cross, the devil didn't stop. The devil spoke through that criminal next to him, "If you're the Son of God, come down and take us with you." His own people said, "If you're the Messiah, prove it to us right now, then we'll believe in you." Jesus recognized and resisted those temptations to the point of death. So as the children told us this morning, he gave everything, his blood, his life, so that we can be forgiven. Jesus conquered temptation. Jesus defeated the devil. By looking at his death, rejoicing in the empty tomb, God delivers that victory to us. That's the life of repentance that we get to live in every day. You're not going to find the perfect Bible study. You're not going to find the perfect small group of believers to gather with. You're not going to find the best hymn or the best style of worship or the perfect way to serve the Lord that's going to make this all make sense in your mind. That's going to give you a strategy to overcome temptation. What you find as a repentant child of God in his word and in his sacrament is the Lord Jesus himself. Living in that life of repentance means a focus on the word and sacrament and receiving all of the blessings that Jesus won for us. You know, Adam and Eve, when they sinned and brought it into the world, it infected all of us, and we're still living in that every day. We all have that part of us. But Jesus more powerfully crushed the head of the devil and delivered us from the bondage of sin and death and hell and gives us that victory through the gospel. That's a proven strategy for us. Not because we've figured it out, not because of our strength and ability, but because of our Savior Jesus and his powerful message of forgiveness that we get to live in every day. And that's real value for life. That's real strength for life in this world. Life that is so chaotic and seems so out of control. Following this strategy that focuses us on Christ, that gives us something to work with. It gives us a good balance. You know, there are people that are completely carefree spiritually. And maybe sometimes we find ourselves there. We're just not thinking about the Word of God. And there's other times where people are so worked up about one simple issue that they can't get off of it. Jesus puts us in the middle. Reminds us, yeah, we take seriously the Word of God and the need to plan spiritually because the Bible gives us that encouragement. But we also recognize that so many things are in God's hands. Everything is. We don't have to be afraid of living in this world. We don't have to be afraid of being out with people. No, we follow this proven strategy of recognizing and resisting and repenting. And then we're equipped to face anything that God brings into our life, to face any situation. I haven't mentioned the fourth part yet, this whole repeat. But that's an important part for us. It's repeating this cycle. number of years ago, I remember my congregation in Tennessee who worked at the county jail, and I had noticed on a local website somebody that I knew had been arrested and had been put in jail. And so I asked this member about the process of getting access to go visit this gentleman in jail. And when I told her his name, she used a term that I was not familiar with in that context. She said, "Oh yeah, he's a frequent flyer." But I don't think so. He stays pretty much in town here. And she meant, no, he's here all the time. He's in and out of jail constantly. That's a term that people in that jail use for the folks that come back to jail over and over again, a frequent flyer. Does God view you that way? Frequent flyer when it comes to sin? Back again, are you? Week after week, day after day, here they are, these frequent flyers. These people who just can't seem to get it together, who can't follow this proven strategy. And they're right back here again. Does God see us that way? Of course he does, because he sees the truth. But God does not give us some derogatory name. He doesn't look down on us. No, he welcomes us. Us frequent flyers. Us people that are in this repeating cycle that means we're going to fall short of God's glory. He's going to show it to us, and he's going to do what he always does. Comfort us with his word and sacrament. That's a proven strategy. Not to give you some new insight into how to never commit a sin again or to finally overcome the one that's been nagging you. No, it's a strategy that's going to focus you on your Savior. It's a strategy that God's going to use to give you joy in your life that you can't find anywhere else. Because it's looking at Jesus, his death for your sins, his promise of forgiveness and eternal life, and the vision that comes only through Jesus of the eternal life that he's prepared for you in heaven. Brothers and sisters in Christ, follow the strategy. Work at it. Recognize where the devil gets after you. Ask God to guide you through his word, to resist those temptations, to stand strong. Live a life of repentance, because we all fail. We all fall into sin. But God does what he always does, brings forgiveness to his repentant children and strengthens us to carry on until that day when he delivers us safely home to heaven. May God strengthen us through his word, continue with that proven strategy. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard your hearts and your minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. Please stand, join together to confess our Christian faith, the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became fully human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated. This time we'll gather our thank offering to the Lord. In our prayers this morning, remember the family of Dean Budak. Dean has been a member here at Abiding Word for about a year or so, and the Lord called him home Thursday morning. His funeral will be up in the Twin Cities area. His family's from that part of the state of Minnesota. Sometime later in April, we'll keep the Budak family in our prayers this morning. Please stand. Heavenly Father, you love the world and gave your Son to liberate us from sin and death by his obedient death on the cross. We confess that without your love, we are lost. Lord of the church, we thank you for the treasure of the gospel. By your Spirit, keep our eyes fixed on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. Strengthen our determination to do what pleases you, no matter what the danger or the cost. We pray for those who carry a cross in the name of Christ and face ridicule and persecution for the sake of the kingdom, missionaries and chaplains, young people who stand up for what is right in the face of pressure to do what is wrong, and all who pay a high price for their faith and their values as Christians. By your Spirit, O Lord, grant them patience and endurance. Let us pray for those who have heavy burdens in life, the sick and the chronically ill, the depressed and the lonely, those torn by conflict and personal relationships, those victimized by war, injustice, and disease, all who face the terrors of life with a heavy heart. Grant them peace, O Lord, and in your mercy, be their guardian and friend, their comfort and their hope. As Heavenly Father, we remember especially today the family of Dean Budak. In your mercy, you called Dean to your side this past Thursday morning. We thank you for delivering him safely to his heavenly home. Be with his family as they grieve with hope of the loss of their loved one, hope that comes from knowing Jesus died and rose again, and so you bring with Jesus those who fall asleep in him. Teach us all to number our days aright, that we may gain hearts of wisdom and finally be saved. And until that day when you call us home, help us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Keep us faithful even to the point of death, that we may receive the crown of life through Jesus Christ our Lord, who also taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly good and right that we should at all times and in all places give you thanks, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and everlasting God. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who brought the gift of salvation to all people by his death on the tree of the cross, so that the devil, who overcame us by a tree, would in turn by a tree be overcome. Therefore, with all the saints on earth and hosts of heaven, we praise your holy name and join their glorious song. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. Good thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take it, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant. It was poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." And the peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
Please be seated. All things are now ready. We invite our communicant members, please come forward to the direction of the ushers.
Thank you.
Join us singing the song of Simeon. We give you thanks, O Lord, for the foretaste of the heavenly banquet that you have given us to eat and to drink in this sacrament. Through this gift, you fed our faith, nourished our hope, and strengthened our love. By your Spirit, help us to live as your holy people until that day when you will receive us as your guests at the wedding supper of the Lamb, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And brothers and sisters, go in peace. Live in harmony with one another and serve the Lord with gladness. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen. We join in our last hymn, Abide, O Dearest Jesus, verse 1, 2, 5, and 6.